Hello, RetroWicked here. Today I will present you the iBook G3 500, an Apple consumer laptop from 2001. It has quite an interesting configuration and is in a very good condition. I will show you some applications running, and of course we are going to talk about the configuration itself. And what are the pros and cons of this laptop? So, let me show you how the laptop looks. On the front side, you will notice the latch mechanism, which actually is quite nice, a durable system, even if the case itself is plastic. On the right side, you may notice a missing place where it would have been the placement for the battery. You may notice the connector over here and a broken locking mechanism. It doesn't matter too much because ultimately over here the battery can still create issues if it's worn out, for instance short circuits or bulging may damage the case, and in the case of the short circuit, of course, it may damage the internal circuitry. So the battery has been removed even if it's available. If we discuss about the case, let me point out two other facts. The first one is that the laptop doesn't have the original fit, because there was a small issue with them. When those feet are going to be removed, in order to get inside the case, you will inevitably break them, and unfortunately there is no easy solution to find the replacement. So I had to use a makeup fit, and that's it. So going around the case, you may notice the special screws that are screw caps that are going to be used. So you will need special screwdrivers. You cannot use the typical Phillips screw head type. Of course, the case itself is made out of plastic. It's quite fragile. Fortunately enough, if you are careful when you take the case apart in order to access the internal hard drive, you can mostly make do without breaking it, but you should be very careful. I just show you these issues because it's highly typical for a laptop of this age to have a damaged or a slow working hard drive. So if you are into retro computing, you have to be well aware of this. Alright, over here in the mid part, you may notice the fins, the cooling from the cooling area. A fan sits inside and blows air over this side. It's somewhat effective, but you still have to understand that cooling on laptops made at the beginning of 2000s was not necessarily pleasant in terms of noise, and the cooling capability was small compared with modern computers. On the right side, you're going to notice the port selection that has a modem, a typical Ethernet connector, a FireWire port, two USB ports. This is actually very important because some prior G3 iBook models had just a single USB port. Of course, we are not talking about USB 2.0, it's USB 1. And a monitor port, as well as jack audio output. What is important, of course, unfortunately, is that you need a separate adapter in order to use this connector with a screen. So you should keep this in mind in case the screen is worn out, or you may be expecting to plug just an LCD screen and be done with everything. Unfortunately, in the case of older Apple laptops, this is not the case. Of course, even new one may have some sort of port that requires specific adapters. And the cooling grill for the hard drive. And of course, you notice again the screws. You may see over here, let me show you, a very small crack, and this is normal. Keep in mind that this laptop was never opened on the screen's housing, yet cracks appeared because the plastic is quite fragile, and unfortunately the way in which the mounting is being done has not helped too much with aging. So okay, we are moving on the right side. We have the power supply input, which unfortunately uses a quite reliable but not necessarily the greatest connector type, but it's going to survive quite well. And the optical drive. The optical drive is actually not a DVD reader. It's just a CD-ROM drive, but this was typical for lower end models. All right, so let's see the upper side. You may have noticed a slight reflection, and this is due to the fact that the case is slightly translucent, which looks very good in person, but you have to think seriously that is a scratch magnet. So you have to be very understanding of the laptop's state, because it's very hard to keep it in perfect condition. All right, so let me show you the power adapter, just a moment. All right, the power adapter is your typical Apple one of the era. You may notice the cable, and of course this is the connector. It's a coaxial connector that can survive quite well some uses, but don't have very high hopes for it. You may notice the housing that is made out of metal. This is due to the fact that the adapter itself is from a PowerBook model, which had an aluminium housing. The typical connector for iBooks was white, due to the fact that the laptop itself was white. This was actually highly common on Apple laptops as a differentiating factor for models. Okay, so let's plug it in. And turn it on. You may notice the light. Well, if there is some sort of fiddling, you may notice that the light changed slightly to yellow. This is due to the fact that when the connection is not well enough done, the light is going to change. This is a good indication, but actually shows that the connector may have some issues. Unfortunately, this is very common. All right. Immediately, you will notice the keyboard that is slightly translucent, a milky white color, if you like to call it that way. The speakers that are on the left and right side near the keyboard. Of course, they are quite small, and you don't have to expect high audio quality through them. But they are fine for a laptop of this age. The trackpad, that is quite comfortable, slightly larger than on typical laptops of that time. The single trackpad button, which was a common staple of Apple computers since I think the beginning of their tenure, due to the fact that Apple was highly adamant of having just a single button, so that the way in which users would operate the computer would be as straightforward as possible. Unfortunately, as the computer experience showed, two buttons were entirely useful for users. So this is why the single button mouse is more of an oddity, but an oddity that remained with Apple up until the current time. So the operating system is still more reliant on a single click than on the left and the right click. Actually, all clicks should be considered a left click. All right, the keyboard itself is very interesting because you can also slide it out. If you are just going to press on these two sliders, and of course the middle one should also be turned lower, and if you're going to be successful, the keyboard can be tilted. Unfortunately, due to the laptop's design, this doesn't give you too much access. You have just the internal wireless card that is going to be easily removed, and the memory. But that's just about it. The hard drive requires entire disassembly of the laptop, which is, as I mentioned, very difficult. But cleaning the keyboard is quite quite easy to do. Over here you have a magnet that has a similar matching component over here, so that when the laptop is assembled back, if I remember correctly, this is the way in which the laptop's top case is going to be signaled as being closed instead of a mechanism. But I'm not entirely sure, so don't take that too seriously. All right, let's place it back. Just a moment. I think it's not well aligned, so let me try that again. Okay. The keyboard itself is quite nice, has a pleasant feedback and feel to it. So I think it's one of the good Apple keyboards compared with modern ones that are shallower. Of course, the keyboard itself is a preference. If you are into a specific keyboard type, you don't have to take it very seriously. You notice the typical Apple keys. All right, so without further ado, let's start the laptop. I'm going to mention just a small fact that the laptop is configured right now to run the standard, the typical macOS 9.2. This is more of a choice for you to see that the laptop is highly versatile, because modern or more modern Apple laptops are not able to run OS 9.2. All right, let me show you the screen slightly better. All right, I think this one is good. Let me see if I can make slightly better. I'm sorry, but focusing requires a bit of fiddling. Yes, just a moment. Unfortunately, I think we will have to make do with with the current setup, just a moment, because it looks overly bright. Yes, I think this one is acceptable. The laptop screen is actually quite nice. It has good contrast. The colors look very nice. The only downside is that yes, it's a typical LCD screen with a fluorescent lamp, which means that the laptop's LCD lifetime is not going to be as great as more modern ones, but it's a very pleasant screen to see. And of course, this one is a laptop that is almost in pristine condition. So that is very nice. What else I can say? Well, this macOS 9.2 installation is very basic. Well, it's actually basic. It's as basic as you can get. Not many installations can be, let's say, slimmer than this, because it's just being shown over here as a proof of concept rather than a typical system you may use on a daily basis. And this is how the typical interface would look on macOS 9 installations. It's quite nice, nothing to brag about, but of course it's obviously outdated, and I'm not going to have any sort of sugar coating on this. Let me just arrange a bit the folder so that you can see it better. Yes, unfortunately we don't have a text editor to show, but I will show you some very simple applications, such as the typical calculator. The typical calculator deserves a special mention because it's an application that has been in the classic macOS since the first version of the system that was supplied by Apple. And it's quite a strange, let's say, application, in the sense that it looks so much different from even all the late macOS 9.2 applications, because it was developed, I think, at the time the operating system was presented more than, let me see, 15 years. Yes, it's an application that is that old. And of course, right now it's even older than that. But yes, that's where everything started in terms of Macs. All right. Let me show you how the system appearance control panel looks like. It's typical. You notice the typical title bar, the control buttons on the left and the right side, and just about everything about the interface is as typical as you can get. The macOS 9.2 interface at the time was fairly typical. From macOS 8, actually, I think, if I remember correctly, from macOS 7 up to 9, there was very little difference in the actual system design or the graphical user interface. But it was quite pleasant. Of course, as time went by, it started to seem very dated, but that's it. All right, and one more thing I would like to show you, how you can switch the operating system, because dual booting is actually entirely possible, and it's one of the reasons for which I started this presentation not with the operating system that was typically running on such a computer, but an older one, so that we can see the major benefits of having such an old laptop and computer configuration. So let me see if we are going to startup. You're going to see the choice of either running macOS 9.22 or macOS X 10.3. If we are going to make the choice of Untitled system, if I remember correctly. We can start with the other system folder that runs the typical macOS 10 installation. Other than that, yes, you can see the typical tray of macOS that was typically busy, and this was on a standard installation. If more applications would be running, of course, this launcher would get even longer than that, but that's it. That's the current situation that was present. Of course, macOS was highly deserving of a graphical update, and macOS 10 provided it. Okay, so let's start macOS 10.3. Of course, restarting is going to take some time. You notice the different startup screen. And slowly the operating system is going to get into running condition. You have to think that the loading time is actually lower than what a typical Mac of the era for two major reasons. The fact that the system has higher RAM capacity, and the fact that the hard drive has been replaced. The hard drives of that time were notorious for being very slow, and running macOS 10 was already demanding for such a system. You have to remember the fact that this is just a power processor, a power PC that is running at 500 MHz. Which is very low for, let's say, typical macOS installations. And you have to understand the fact that macOS 10 was highly demanding on the processor and on the rest of the hardware configuration. So running with a system of this age was possible, but not necessarily the best option. And many users chose macOS 10 just because it was nicer and had better application support, but on the other side, macOS 9 ran slightly faster. Unfortunately, there is no, let's say, great choice in terms of OS installations, because almost any installation feels quite slow on this laptop, but I think that macOS 10.3 is a very good choice. So let me show you the configuration in just a moment. All right, the configuration, just a moment to make again a proper focusing, sorry for keeping you okay. I think this one is good. So the configuration over here is maxed up. You can't have more than 640 megabytes on the installation. 640 megabytes is provided with the internal RAM that, as far as I can tell, is 128 megabytes, the onboard RAM, and a memory module that is 512 megabytes in size. We are talking about SDRAM, so this is quite a high capacity, and those modules were not entirely common. Of course, it's a bit too much for a system of this day, but keep in mind that any sorts of loading from the hard drive is going to reduce performance, so this is why the memory should be maxed out for such old laptops, because they already don't feel that fast. All right, let me show you the configuration in more detail. You can notice over here the specifications, the memory, as I mentioned, a 512 megabyte memory module that was placed inside the system. The video account is actually quite, let's say, slow for the system, and this is actually one of the major reasons for which the system has limited hardware acceleration capability. It's just an AT Rage, if I remember correctly. Video chipset that has only 8 megabytes of RAM. Of course, more than 8 megabytes of RAM wouldn't help the system more. It's the fact that the video chipset is already quite slow, and this is felt even on similar laptops but made for the standard PC market. And in that case, running I don't know, a demanding 3D game like Quake is going to feel quite slow. And this is going to be, first of all, due to the fact that the video chipset is not fine. And of course, we are talking about a game that was released around 2000, Quake 3, and we are talking about a video card that was released, if I remember correctly, in 1999. So performance wasn't top of the line, and of course, expectations should be according to this. The hard drive, as I mentioned, was replaced from the standard hard drive that was in the initial configuration. First of all, due to the fact that it was quite worn out, and the second, that the system seriously required a faster one in order to cope better with an operating system as demanding as OS X 10.3. And actually, this was a common issue up until 10.4, if I remember correctly, and especially on very old hardware such as the G3 PowerPC. There was very little performance you could expect, but of course, we were much more, let's say, forgiving of longer delays. And this can also be seen on the screen. As you notice, there is a bit of a motion blur that happens on the pointer. And of course, updating is not very very fast. But this was typical of LCD screens of that time. All right, the Epoch count, which actually was a very important capability. Of course, we are not having a proper, let's say, activity out of it, because in general you shouldn't attempt to use it, because unfortunately, except in the case where you have very old networks, you are probably not be able to make a connections, because it doesn't support modern security standards such as VPA2. And unfortunately, I'm not aware of any way of trying to use such an old wireless card with modern networks. But just in case you wanted to see the configuration, I will refresh it. Okay, it's your typical wireless card. As far as I can tell, the AirPort card was compatible with the 802.11b standard, so don't expect very high performance. But just in case your laptop is being supplied with such a card, you can see what the laptop is capable of. Not much, but very good, especially if you think that yes, it's a laptop from 2001. Let me close this application and show you the dock, because the dock was not turned on. Just a moment. And now you can see the typical look of Mac OS installation of that time. The system itself actually is very nice to use. If you are used to running Windows, you will have probably some issues or other operating systems. But on the other side, if you are a bit accustomed to the windowing concept and everything related to it, you will have no trouble with adapting to Mac OS X. It looks very nice. It works quite well, I have to say, first of all, due to the hard drive. And if you want to see how much the system is taxing the resources, You will going to see that there are jumps of around 20% in terms of CPU utilization, even if the laptop is mostly idle. The system memory, as I mentioned, is more than enough. You can see that 500 megabytes of RAM are available. Of course, if you're going to run some demanding applications, this is going to dry up quickly, but it's more than enough. So let me show you just some applications. We are having over here the typical chess. That looks very nice. Of course, it doesn't feel overly fast, first of all, due to the video chipset, and I'm going to show you exactly. You can notice over here a slight delay and a lower frame rate, but it's entirely playable. Of course, this may not be so well running on an even older laptop, but over here it's fine. I'm not going to delve more into chess. Of course, you may notice this very interesting artifact. This was common because the graphics chipset was not entirely compatible with some applications, and especially ones that were hard, that require harder acceleration have this issue. This is important because, as I mentioned, the laptop was designed in 2000, was actually released on the market in 2001. The operating system is from 2003. Unfortunately, if you were thinking about running macOS 10.2 or 10.1, the usability actually goes very fast downhill, and the operating system feels even slower. So I think that macOS 10.3 is the best choice, but I wanted to get back on this so that you understand better the issue with running an operating system on such hardware. All right, the calculator app, that looks quite nice. As you notice, of course, there is a scientific calculator design that looks even nicer, but I'm not going to show you very much out of the calculator app capabilities, but it's very nice. Okay, let's turn it back. And let me show you something else. Of course, Apple was highly interested in pushing the messaging applications such as iChat, everything about internet connectivity. You may notice the strange appearance of Internet Explorer. This was to do the fact that Microsoft heavily invested in Apple's comeback at a time when Apple was not in a very good financial condition, and this meant that the involvement of Microsoft, of course we are talking about Microsoft in the late tenure of Steve Jobs, which was, as we know very well, a person that attempted to push for Apple's independence, but they had to accept the fact that a collaboration with Microsoft was essential for the system's success, especially when its market share was just starting to recover from previous problems. And bundling Microsoft applications such as Internet Explorer was essential to ensure the restart of the reboot, actually, of Apple during that time. And of course, you may notice the Safari web browser. The Safari web browser is very interesting because at that time, I think that macOS 10.3 was the first system to showcase the new Safari browser. And up until that time, Internet Explorer was running as the default web browser. And this was very helpful for Microsoft in both in terms of their collaboration with Apple and, of course, in terms of, let's say, marketing, because ultimately it showed that Microsoft applications were good enough. This was, of course, understood since Netscape and Internet Explorer were running even in previous operating systems such as macOS 9.2. But unfortunately, there were some issues that were never solved, and Apple just made the choice of developing an in-house web browser. So slowly but surely, Internet Explorer was sidelined. Okay, the typical text editor. Chevlog is a searching application that was actually released in previous operating system installations. And it was a centerpiece of the usability advantage of Apple, because you could search for easily in a, let's say, in an integrated way, both on the computer and on the internet. And this was especially at a time when the typical computer user was not very comfortable with running Internet Explorer, and they used or any other browser, and they used the channels or the portals that made it easier to access the internet. And having such an application was very important. Over here, there are of course other applications that have been installed, not many. Benching application and two ones that were used for hex editing. I will not get into more details. Of course, we have the typical iPhoto and iMovie bundle that was used on laptops of this age. Let me just show you the typical application, because there's not much else to see. All right, it looks quite nice. This is in typical Apple fashion, and actually everything about the application was made to be as pleasant as possible for a specific operating system. This is actually quite a nice experience. Let me show you, the next application, iMovie. This was a very important time in Apple's history, because we are starting to see the dawn of DVD authoring and movie editing, due to the fact that cameras have been made, let's say, reasonably affordable, and a typical medium. A typical media actually could be used to transfer the data from a computer that was still not, entirely user friendly, to a DVD player. And this was very important, because at that time TV sets and the ability to work with them, and due to the fact that of course they had a very large screen, made them very attractive for holiday creations for most users. Although of course for some of them it was the start of a movie editing career, so this is entirely understandable. As you may have noticed, I think the application is slightly stuck, so we are going to see what we can do about that. Just a moment, let me see. Okay, let's force quit iMovie. I don't know exactly why it got stuck, but this wasn't entirely uncommon for applications of that time. Alright. And let's move further with the presentation. Yes. All right. It was very common to run QuickTime Player, because it was not only the start of digital media collections stored only as OS files, compared with the typical CD collection, but it was also the start of the iTunes trend that became very important. Of course, over here we are not seeing the iTunes application, but the integration between QuickTime and what became iTunes is very important. That started with the QuickTime Player. The QuickTime Player, of course, was your typical Apple video player, actually the one that was integrated in the operating system, but also one that was attractive enough and supplied for a number of years also on the PC on the PC environment. And this was very important because it ultimately bridged the Mac and PC worlds, especially at a time when videos have started to become popular. And the QuickTime video format was, in some respects, higher quality than your typical MPEG-2 video file. And sharing some files or working with QuickTime formats was entirely possible. All right, let me show you something else. Of course, the application seems to got stuck again. I'm not entirely sure what was the reason for which it got stuck, but we found a way to solve it. And let me show you the iTunes application, because I mentioned the fact that it became famous, because just about any music album that was previously available on your typical format was now possible to find with specific files, which means that only your favorite songs out of that album were possible to be purchased. And this meant that if you wanted just specific songs, you could have them in your collection. And this was very important because it completely changed the paradigm of working with audio files and with the music industry. And of course, Apple's involvement in the industry was very strong, and it meant, of course, that some compromises have to be made, but ultimately it made it possible for an user to purchase just a single song that they enjoyed, and created a different approach to releasing music and focusing less and less on what your typical record house would do, and more on what the users or your fans, your fan base feedback would be. And of course, this got us closer to the present, when actually you could be using the internet to find out just about anything regarding your favorite band. All right, and this was the typical look of the iTunes application. I also wanted to mention something more about iTunes, because this was the start of the trend regarding the iPod, and this is very important, because the iPod started a revolution, I should say, in portability and media consumption, because ultimately you could choose your entire audio collection to be ported on the iPod. You could listen it just about everywhere, and even if at first you could just listen to songs, later you could see videos, and of course this made it much easier for a smartphone to enter the same market and ultimately take over it. So it was just let's say a set or a series of steps that made it possible to reach the current digital age, and this is very interesting to see in retrospect. I think this just about sums up the presentation. As you have noticed, it's a laptop that has quite good capabilities, not necessarily the fastest, and I think the strongest point for it is the fact that it can run older macOS applications, because more modern let's say computers could be running better operating systems such as macOS 10.4, which is especially popular, but on the other side they don't have this flexibility, especially if we are talking about late PowerPC G4 models that totally dumped compatibility and only Let's say the typical classic interface could be run up until a certain point. Of course, late operating systems such as macOS, Leopard and Snow Leopard didn't have any sort of classic environment capability, so the macOS link was totally broken. If you want to run your typical environment, of course you need the applications installed, but ultimately this is how you would handle the settings for it. And regarding the startup, you can specify just as well what system it should be started with in a very user-friendly way. So it's either the one that is currently running or the macOS 9.22. This was actually the way in which we made it possible so that even at startup, the older operating system was running, as you saw at the beginning of the video. So I think that just about wraps it up. I hope you enjoyed the video, and hope you will enjoy further interesting clips about old computers and lighting technology or anything else that let's say is suited. So see you on the RetroWicked YouTube channel, and also please visit adnotech.ro, where you will see a quite nice database of information for let's say classic laptops and lighting technology, and especially you're going to notice some very interesting details about older technology. So I hope you enjoy this, and goodbye. Let me show you just how the system can be turned off, and yes, we are going to end up this presentation.